This kind of virtualization works quite similarly. Every VM has an I/O ring, which is dedicated for disk I/O. This is an I/O ring associated with VM1. This is an I/O ring associated with VM2. Similar to network virtualization, here also the communication between the guest operating system and Xen strives to avoid copying altogether. No copying into Xen, because what we're doing is we are enqueuing descriptors for the disk I/O that we want to get done with pointers to the guest operating system buffers where the data is already contained if the transfer has to go into the disk, or a placeholder for the data to come into from the disk. And the philosophy being asynchronous I/O, enqueuing these descriptors into this I/O ring by the guest operating system happens asynchronously with respect to Xen enqueuing responses back for prior requests coming from this VM. Since Xen is in charge of the actual devices, in particular, in this case, the disk subsystem, it may reorder requests from competing domains in order to make the I/O throughput efficient. But there may be situations where such request reordering may be inappropriate from the semantics of the I/O operation, and therefore, Xen also provides a reorder barrier for guest operating systems to enforce that do these operations in exactly the order in which I've given them. Such a reorder barrier, for instance, may be necessary for higher level semantics such as write ahead, logging, and things like that. So that completes discussion of all the subsystems that need to be virtualized, whether it is by a fully virtualized environment or a para-virtualized environment. Next, we will talk about usage and billing.